Life yan, ha? Sa Ronald, baka may sasabihin ka.
Nakahat ka lahat nila ng mukha ni Ronald nakikita.
Live na yan.
Okay,
tayo dyan. Okay, okay. And then this will be the YouTube one. Wait lang, sir. Give us 20 seconds. Yeah, they're both live. Magsistart na yan. Kasabay na natin yung kabilang channel yata ngayon na naabutan tayo ng 8:30. So, bam, it will focus on you kasi ikaw, yung, okay. Ikaw lang may lapel.
Musta? Dito kami ngayon, we have ano, we are at the presence of two senatoriables.
An ex and a future ex and another future.
Former and
future and future ex.
And ano.
Okay.
Pag-ibay ko, nabubuso.
Ilabas mo na yung shirt mo, bro. Wait lang. Ayun. Ayun. Okay, okay. Ang problema ko lang, magtasigla ako ay tayo dito. Wag masyado malapit. We need some...
It's okay. We will share sa live.
Yeah! That's... Oh. That's...
Sabi nga, magkakaamuyan tayo
medyo,
tonight.
Medyo, yeah, yeah. This is a... okay, let's go. Pakiyanin na lang, boss. Okay na to sa audio. Sige, let's start in... 5, 4. Huwag ka naman conscious pa kung may mga nag-troll dyan eh. That's part of the business. It's engaging and all of that. Okay, let's go. Okay, everyone, welcome back to the latest episode of RRM, the best Tres Mario Super Marios. There's a Super Mario version, but our concern was trademark. So ginawa namin ilustrado. So today, of course, we have a special guest. I'm sure hindi nyo kilala yan, so you know, we need a 2-hour introduction later on. Pero pwede siguro nyo i-Google or Wikipedia yan. Obviously, this is part of our discussions about history, kasaysayan. Gusto natin maintindihan kasaysayan. Of course, makasaysayan na araw ngayon, which is something we're gonna discuss. And of course, it's not only a discussion about the past, it's also about the future. On that note, welcome to RRM, Project Pilipinas Show.
Thank you, salamat.
Ano pangalan niyo ulit, sir?
Bamakino
po. Bamakino, yeah.
These days, Bamakino po.
Yes, yes.
Richard, hi, Mark. Sir Ronald, magandang gabi. Good evening, everyone, sa mga nanonood.
Good evening, good evening. Alright, so ang may kasalanan na inibita ka namin is Mark Gamboa. You wanna get the ball rolling, sir?
Yeah. Salamat, Mark, sa
hindi, syempre, pag-imbita. Of course, kahapon as Ninoy Day, Ninoy Aquino Day.
Yes.
Oh, medyo nakakalito din kasi bukas pa yung holiday. We're taping this on a Thursday. So yun, so itong podcast episode, we want to allocate a big part of it talking about Ninoy the person, Ninoy the politician, and your family.
Yeah.
And of course, thank yung you. Mga naging atake sa kanya nitong mga nakaraang mga taon. Mm.
Yes, 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 yes.
So siguro I want to ask lang, growing up, how was it like to be part of the Aquino family, Ninoy and...
Well, and your name, I mean, you're Benigno, right?
Yeah,
you're,
I'm Paolo Benigno. Actually, named after ako, my uncle. So I was born in 77. So nakakulong na siya noon. And yung isang point of pride ko dyan is dun sa kulungan niya, meron siyang... So nakakulong siya for 7 years and 7 months. No? I mean, a lot of people don't realize ganun siya katagal nakakulong nung panahon yun. And meron siyang kalendaryo dun sa selda niya. And nakabilog the day after my birthday, which is May 8. So May 7 birthday ko, nakabilog yung May 8. It's a boy, Paul Benigno IV. You know, and kumbaga yun yung aking, that's the only evidence I have na alam niya yung presence ko. Diba? Kasi I was really young during that time. I was 6 nung pinatay siya. I was 3 years old nung umalis siya ng Amerika. And wala akong real memory of meeting my uncle, which is one of my regrets. I don't know kung si Sir Ronald, na-meet mo ba si Tito Ninoy ever?
Hindi
rin, no? Baka sa college ka noon, no?
Masang kabarkada ko si Butch.
Si Tito Butch, okay. Of course, continued the fight in the 80s na, di ba? Mm. But kwento sa akin ni Senator Kiko, siya, youth leader siya nung 80s. Kahit sila, mga youth leader, hindi na rin nila masyadong kilala si Ninoy Aquino at that time. Kasi nakulong siya at 39 years old.
Oh, wow.
I mean, it's
you're 39, right? That's your age, bro.
I'm 47. So, that's...
You're 47?
That's right. Ikaw na ko ba? May 40 ka na ba?
No!
Ka
no!
32 ka na ba? Kano ka na?
Yeah, I'm mid-30s.
Okay, mid-30s. mid-30s.
You're 47. Wow, you look young, bro.
Thank you, salamat.
Actually, bumata ka lala, in fairness.
Natuwa sa ako. Natuwa sa ako.
But bolero lang ako. Legit na. I was surprised. I thought you're like early 40s.
You look younger than Richard.
Wow! Ronald, I want to say something.
People don't realize, he was really young. Sobra siyang bata nung kinulong siya. He was 39 nung kinulong siya. He was 47 nung na-exile siya. And he was 50 when he passed away, when he was killed. Yeah. Diba? And I had more years in the Senate than Tito Rinoy had years in the Senate. Kasi mabilis na panahon lang, nakulong na siya. People forget na he was prisoner number one during martial law.
Right.
Umabot siya ng 7 years and 7 months. Sa mga politiko noong time na yun, siya na yung record holder. Eh. Si the next one was Pepe Jokno at about 2 years.
Right.
But most other people, tama da, Sir Ronald, parang isang linggo, dalawang linggo, isang buwan, di ba? Nakalaya na.
Yes, yes.
Pero I asked Chell nga, sabi ko, Chell, bakit yung tatay mo at yung tito ko yung pinakamatagal sa kulungan? Sabi niya, baka sila pinakapasaway nung panahong yun.
Yeah.
Di ba? So they were kept the longest in jail. So, growing up,
sa BGC to, no?
At the fort and in Lahore
BGC
also.
Sorry, BGC tawag
yeah, the, it was, of course, Fort Bonifacio.
Exactly,
yeah. He spent most of his years there. Pero may panahon rin siya sa Lahore. When that was the time na hindi nila siya mahanap and they weren't sure kung ano yung nangyayari. So, I was a baby nung biyadala ako doon, nung magulang ko. And ang kwento nila is magbimisa every Sunday.
Right.
And dala-dala ako, tapos si Tito Rinoy, magjo-joke daw yan. Iwan niya tong baby na to dito. Iwan niya, iiyak daw ako. That was the joke every weekend. But I don't have a memory of that. Wala akong memory nun.
Walang vlog, walang live,
wala.
Podcast.
Wala. There's just one photo.
Photo.
That's just it. One photo na dala-dala niya ako.
Oh, wow.
And that's my only time na physically magkasama kami. So,
you still have that?
I think my mom still has it, honestly. Kailangan kong hanapin.
Yeah, maybe. Oh. Yeah.
Yeah, but
I mean, you're the torch holder now, man.
But kumbaga it's peculiar for me kasi laking bagay niya sa buhay ko. And yet, yun lang talaga yung moment na yun. It's not even a real memory on my part. It's a story of my parents na nung bata ka, nandito ka, ganyan. And then I was 6 when he was killed. That's 83. So hindi ka pa pinapanganak noon, hindi ka pa rin pinapanganak noon. Si Sir Ronald siguro.
Sir Ronald, medyo senior citizen na siya
noon.
Senior citizen na si Ronald.
Fourth-year college.
Fourth-year college. So you were in the thick of things na. Nasa student movement kaya noon.
I was the first president of the student council in UST at the time.
Tama ba? Did you guys know about who he was? Kasi yung kwento sa akin nila Kiko, yung mga student leaders daw noon, niya daw siya kilala.
Well, kilala namin siya. Dalawa naki-influence sa akin eh. Si Pepe Jokno at saka si Ninoy. Dahil very articulate sila, very eloquent, no? At siguro kaya sila yung pinakamatagal. Dahil ang kilala ko sa kanilang dalawa, sila ang pinakamagaling na eloquent na mga senators noon. Yung kaya mong si Ninoy at saka si Pepe,
oratorical,
kaya mong patawanin yung crowd,
kaya mong paiyakin,
kaya mong galitin, kaya mong patahimikin, yung buong range ng human emotion, yung dalawa ang nakita kong
the best. You know, one of the biggest compliments nung Monday, no? So I have every Monday nasa Magic ako with Mo Twister and Alex Calleja and Sam O.
Mo Twister is back?
Yeah, he's back. Matagal na. But he's in the States. So
remote siya. Okay.
Sabi ni Alex, of course, stand-up comedian, inaral niya yung LA speech ni Tito Rinoy sa delivery niya of punchline. And for me, sobrang kinilig dun sa sinabi niya. Yeah, because he was really a funny guy.
Yeah.
People just remember the moment na pinatay siya, but he was a real person, di ba? With his own story, his own story arc, his own redemption arc, sa totoo lang, because he was a very different person bago siya kinulong and a very different person nung nakalabas siya. People don't talk about that,
can
actually.
Can I pick on that? I mean, parang we can do the young Ninoy and the, you know, the redemptive, you know. A couple of interesting things, no? One of the discussions I have with some of my historian friends is, apparently there's a, I don't know if it's rumor or more than rumor, that at night daw tinatawag ni Marcos Sr. si Ninoy to have some long conversation until morning or something like that. Parang he saw him as his peer or something like that. Or at least, even if it's rumor, if it's just a rumor, the idea was that Marcos Sr. saw Ninoy as his only real peer,
parang,
intellectually and all.
Parang rival.
Rival. And parang, pare, pasensya na, unaan lang to, di ba? Parang ganun. Because both very ambitious men, both quite young, both
brads,
brilliant. Both brilliant and all of that. And parang the idea was, sorry na lang, it was just a matter of who, you know, pulls the trigger earlier, but I still respect you. We are peers, we are rivals.
I know that there was at least one conversation na nakwento sa akin ng
right.
And I know of one conversation at least. Hindi ko alam kung madalas yun, but I know that there
was
moments
at least
na nag-uusap sila. Yung isa speech naman niya, di ba? Sinabi niya na sinasabihan siya, pag nagkita kayo ni Marcos, sabihin mo, okay na tayo. Friends na tayo ulit, papalayain ka. That's his speech, sa LA speech niya. But, you know, he never did that.
And I doubt it will work. I think Marcos Sr. is more Machiavellian than that.
Well, at that time kasi, karamihan yata, nag-compromise na eh, di ba? Yeah. Parang, okay na tayo, peace na tayo, tapos pinalaya sila, di ba? So in his case, I don't think ginawa niya yun. And umabot siya ng 7 years and 7 months, and it took a heart attack. And aminado naman siya, tuwan-tuwa siya nung pinaalis siya eh. Sabi niya, I was, in his speech, he says, di ba, parang sa tuwa ko, binigay ko pa yung anting-anting ko kay Melody, di ba? That's the speech, right? So, like any human being, nung pinalaya siya, tuwan-tuwa talaga siya. And he spent those years in America, he had a regular life there, nagturo siya sa Harvard. So, di ba, they say CIAC, Ninoy Aquino, but that's actually Center for International Affairs ng Harvard, ng Harvard University.
Oh, yeah.
Oo, so the CIA, totoo naman CIA, pero Center for International Affairs, no? Unfortunate na pareho yung acronym niya.
There are other centers you could have, you know, like work, I would have suggested him in CIA. Harvard, yeah.
So,
during that time, the US government is still supporting
That famous toast, di ba, na for democracy, di ba?
Icon of democracy.
That's George Bush.
When is this?
During the Reagan years.
Reagan, 80s, early 80s. Yeah.
George Bush Sr. was assigned to go here.
He went here.
At may video yan na tinatoast niyang mga Marcos for icons of democracy. Yeah. Oh, of course, mga 18th year na nila yun na presidente sila, di ba? So he had that life. And yet, umuwi siya. And I think more than the fact na nabaril siya, kasi I always say yung nabaril kasi siya, that was done to him, di ba? Pero yung act niya, yung ginawa niya, choice talaga niya, was umuwi siya. He chose to go home. In his mind, pwede siya makulong ulit. Or kung swerte siya, baka ma-house arrest siya.
Right.
Of course, kung mahala siya, baka patayin siya. Mm. But all of those options were there. And he didn't know kung ano yung mangyayari. Hindi niya alam kung ano yung mangyayari sa buhay niya. Tita Cory would say in later years, na yung balak lang naman niya was to talk to Marcos, who was sick at that time, and to ask na mag-transition na tayo back to democracy. So, Tita Cory would say, wala na talaga siyang balak to run. I don't know if you heard, did you hear the opposite, na he was planning on running?
Kasi yun ang pinapalabas ng kabilang side. Kaya lang naman umuwi yan kasi may sakit na si McCoy, gusto niyang maging presidente.
Pero hindi lang kabilang side, Mark, di ba? I mean, I've heard even from neutral historians that the idea was that he saw himself as a unifier. He understood that the Marcos regime was falling apart. There was the debt crisis happening. I think my sense na siya, Marcos was unwell already. There was already factional between the Enrile faction and you know, Imelda. So, I won't be surprised if part of him didn't see it as a personal ambition, but it's kind of a personal mission to bring the country together. Because in a sense, niya, you need the post-Marcos transition, and he's the best guy to carry the torch.
Definitely.
Medyo controversial pa nga yan. Yung iba sinasabi ay pwede naman siyang naghintay pa for a while. Yung iba sinasabi ay kinausap siya ng ilang Liberal Party leaders para bumalik to lead the opposition. Dahil nga nagsisimula na mag-unite yung opposition nun. Eh, no? So,
I'm sure maraming kumusap sa kanya. Bilang isang politiko, maraming talagang kakausap sa'yo. But I'll go with Tita Cory's final interview. She had one interview before she passed away, and that's in the documentary, yung Last Journey of Dinoy. And doon na sinabi na yung balak naman niya was just to talk to Marcos and transition back to democracy. So, of course, maniniwala tayo kay Tita Cory, di ba? So, yun yung pinakabalak niya, di ba? I mean, that's the only thing he wanted. And he knew, at the minimum, ikukulong siya.
Yeah, and he felt that he could be killed and in public pa. I mean, the pain it will cause his loved ones.
Well, I think he said that kasi maraming tumatawag eh. Na, oh, baka delikado buhay mo. Few people called him. Kasi yung last journey niya to go to the Philippines, ang rami niyang dinaanan. Duman siyang Malaysia, duman siyang Taiwan. Yeah. And every step, may mga tumatawag sa kanya. Wag friends, supporters, either huwag ka nang umuwi or mga, ito yung mangyayari pag uwi mo, di ba? But there were definitely a few who said, baka yung buhay mo delikado. And still, inuwi pa rin siya. So, I think when people talk about bravery, yung katapangan, yung heroism, we have to look at that eh. Na, here's a person who was presidentiable. I mean, literally presidential.
Youngest senator ever?
Ever. Will forever be because they changed the rules.
Yeah.
And then, sobrang high flyer, sobrang achiever, sobrang, di ba, touted to be the next president. And then, suddenly, prisoner number one. Nakakulong ka for almost 8 years, largely forgotten. Tumakbo ka in 1978 from your jail cell, lost, di ba? Lost, although nagka-noise barrage, lost. Napalaya, masaya sa Amerika, pero umuwi. Right. And I think if you look at that arc, you will see somebody who chose to go home, chose to be part of the Philippines, no, dito sa struggle natin dito. And yun yung isang nakakalimutan. Kasi nakikita lang natin, pinatay, napatay, di ba? And nakakalimutan natin yung journey na yun. If you go even further, Ninoy Aquino, the politician, was really a...
Yeah, I want to talk about that kasi parang there's almost two, I won't say mythos, I won't say mythos. The first one is the Icarus, like young, ambitious, got too close to the sun and
totoo
he got
yan.
Burned.
Totoo
but
yan.
The second one is almost redemptive, it's very Christian,
because
if I can put it that way.
Because nagbago kasi siya eh.
Exactly. Can we talk about that? The reason I talk about this, Bami, is because one of the most interesting insights I've heard is ang idol ni Digong daw was the young Ninoy. Not in the sense that it could be, but in the sense that he could talk to all sides.
Maybe, but Digong himself has always said na he wouldn't be in public office kung wala si Tita Cory.
And that's true. So there's always that weird Aquino connection of inspiration. Of,
because his
of
mother was the head of the opposition
in
Davao.
And they gave way to him. Yeah,
you know the story, diba?
Yeah, so, that one I know. But what people don't know is that he actually looked up to Ninoy as a classic synthesizer. The guy who could talk to people across the political spectrum, get things going on. That's what I understand.
To be fair, never niya nakwento yun sa akin. Ang nakwento lang niya sa akin, when he was mayor and I went, you know, naka-yellow pa siya nung panahon yun, 2013, if you remember.
Kasama sila doon sa motorcade na naka...
At that time, nung nakausap ko siya and naka-yellow rin siya noon, he would always say na yung mother niya was the head of the opposition during martial law.
Right.
And in fact, when Tita Cory would go to Davao, yung nanay niya at si Tita Cory, yung magkasama sa sakyan, and his mother would be the one driving Tita Cory around. And Tita Cory offered his mom to be the OIC vice mayor, and the mother said, wag na lang ako, yung anak ko na lang kasi mas bata siya sa akin. And that's President Duterte. So there's that
Digong Dilaw. I think that's the term, right? Digong Dilaw.
May history na gano'n. That's real. I mean, that's a real history.
Yeah, that I think is well known. I wanted to ask you because this is the less known or controversial or questionable take that actually...
Idol niya si Tito Ninoy. I don't know about that.
I'm talking young Ninoy. That ambitious, Icarus guy, you know, who could, you know, talk to the communists, talk to the, you know, the Americans, talk to the politicians, work the party through, you know, like the ultimate consummate politician. In
actually,
that sense,
yung isang mahalagang element dyan ay napunta siya sa politika because of EDSA. Mm-hmm. And wala siyang balak maging politiko eh. Naging vice
this
mayor
Digong,
siya.
This is Digong, right? This is Digong.
Digong. Naging vice
sorry,
mayor
yeah,
siya
sorry.
Because of EDSA.
Yeah.
Nung panahon na yun.
Yeah.
Actually, inarang pa nga siya ni Nene Pimentel.
Ah, really?
Oo, dahil ang apelido niya, Roa.
Okay.
Roa kalaban mga kaaway ng mga Pimentel yan sa Mindanao.
Yeah, hindi ko alam yan.
So nung una ay ayaw siyang payagan na ano inappoint sila noon eh after EDSA. No? Kaya eventually yung ang gusto lang niya
that.
Gusto niya maging tawag iba tawag dati yung ombudsman, yung local ombudsman,
prosecutor ish.
Yun yung gusto niya, pero lawyer siya, no?
Yeah, well, fiscal na siya eh. Fiscal na siya at that time,
di ba? Yeah, pero yung parang ombudsman type yung gusto niya. No? Yung ganung klase niya.
Ay mga interesting histories, di ba? Yeah. But going back, si Tito Ninoy, he was the youngest everything. No, he was a youngest journalist at 17
Korean,
who covered
Korean
the
War.
Korean War at 17.
Yeah.
He was a young vice mayor, a young mayor, a young vice governor, one of the youngest governors, and then the youngest senator in our history.
And he covered the Jabida massacre? What was it, that angle?
No, that was during the Senate days na yon.
Yes.
Senate days
na
yon. Oh, yeah.
Expose.
Debate na yan over Sabah, Malaysia.
Yeah.
That was his expose.
Expose niya yun.
Na pinatay yung mga na-train, di ba?
Special forces. We're supposed to go there and get the ball rolling.
Something
diba?
Like that,
yeah,
di ba?
Yeah.
And that was one of his big exposes.
Yes.
So he was also known for his exposes.
Fiscalizer.
Anong tawag doon?
Gusto ni Marcos na i-take over ng Sabah. Mm. Parang part ng isang plot yun.
Ano nga? Project Sagittarius ba?
Yes.
So martial law was called Project Sagittarius and he had also exposed na may gantong plot and of course walang naniwala. Tama na, walang naniwala at that time. Masyadong fantastical to imagine na magma-martial law ang isang demokrasya. Diba? At that time, ano nangyari siya?
Because we are the oldest democracy in this region.
Kumbaga, at that time, di mo maisip na magdi-dictatorship ang Pilipinas. Even though maraming dictatorship sa paligid natin noong panahon yun, yung mga Pilipino mismo and yung mga politiko, di nila ma-imagine na gagawin ni Marcos yun. Pero ginawa nila, di ba?
So Ninoy could see that. He had that kind of sophistication.
Well, he had the intel, actually.
Yeah.
But he was also known to get a lot of intel
that's
from different
saying.
People.
He has a lot of connection,
oh,
right?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
But going back, no, nung senador siya, He was one of the few senators who was also on TV at the same time he was a senator.
Right.
So kumbaga kung ngayon to, siguro nasa TikTok siya or he would be an influence. But he used the new technologies at that time.
Meron siyang show?
Yes. May sarili siyang show at yung director niya, yung tita ko, si Tita Lupita, who's a known director. So, if I'm not mistaken, it was a regular weekly TV show. And that was unique for that time.
So, anong klaseng show siya? Parang they talk about the latest issues, gano'n?
Parang alam ko, magazine show
ba?
Eh.
Parang Dulfo, gano'n?
Alam mo, honestly, hindi ko alam. I can find out. But nagulat lang ako na, even back then, may gano'ng aspeto na siya.
Journalist siya. So,
kaya-kaya niya yung current affairs.
Yung current affairs na
he was one of the first ones who campaigned in a helicopter. So, sikat rin siya for that na nag-hopping siya. Ngayon, medyo normal na yun yung mga tumatakbo na ka-helicopter. Yeah. But at that time, and it was really a small, nakita ko yung photo, it's a small helicopter, parang dalawang tao lang sila. And pupunta sila sa iba't ibang mga probinsya in one go and... Again, it was innovative for that time.
He's definitely an innovator at the cutting edge. I mean, he even reminds me of the Navalny, right? Mm-hmm. Who would do TikTok himself. And this kind of dynamic martyr hero, but complex character politician.
Very complex. Kasi
very
alam
complex
mo,
character.
Right? Like ito ah, kausap ko si Luke Espiritu. Okay, si Luke right. Espiritu. Luke Espiritu is another guy na he always says idol niya si Tito Ninoy.
Interesting. Okay,
so we had a conversation, we captured it for content, no? And sabi niya, you know, alam mo, ako gustong-gusto ko talaga yung tito mo kasi he was pushing for agrarian reform early on.
Yes.
Pero, di ba yun nga yung batikos nga about Luisita and all of that. But on the Aquino side kasi...
Kuhang ko yun eh. Yeah.
Exactly. On the Aquino side, as early as the 70s, I think, all of our land was given away because Tito Ninoy wanted it to be given away as early as then. Yeah.
Inspired by what? Moral grounds? By ideological grounds? What was going on there?
If you ask Attorney Luke, parang may pagka-ideological grounds. I don't know. Yeah. I don't know.
Maybe he's overreading into it.
But the fact na as early as then, he was seen as one of the people who really pushed for agrarian reform, even though maybe hindi niya nagawa with his in-laws.
Yeah.
Pero sa pamilya mismo namin, napamigay niya. Diba? And... again, very complex because he did work in Luisita as a young man. Nagtrabaho rin siya doon. So, alam mo yon, may mga complexities na ganyan. At that time, he was part of the Northern Bloc. Si Tarlac wasn't seen as Central Luzon, it was North.
Yeah.
Ng time na yon. So, Northern Bloc of governors, you know, which included sila Chavit and you know, the
Chavit.
Sa Nueva Ecija, the Cosons, you know, it's part of that bloc also, di ba? In the Senate, did you know na lumipat rin si Tito Ninoy ng partido? You know that?
Yeah.
He went from NP to LP.
LP. Si Marcos naman, LP to NP.
So nag-crossover sila. And this is the pre-Solid North, di ba? Because Solid North is a Marcos consolidation of my region. This is a pre. This is the precursor to Solid North.
So he he's a real person. I guess yun yung pinaka-point ko. Totong tao siya. May sarili siyang history. May mga sarili siyang pinagdaanan, may mga highs and lows. If you look at the legislative record of Tito Ninoy,
right.
His biggest law was study now, pay later. Siya ang nagsabatas ng study now, pay later law. Diba? I mean, nobody talks about, senador siya, ano yung napasa niyang batas? Diba?
Where was he getting all of these ideas? Is the man also ahead of his time? I mean,
alam mo,
ano nag-influence sa kanya?
Yun nga, is this abroad?
Theoreticians, intellectuals?
Honestly, like you don't see that in any of his writings.
Yeah, you need an intellectual history of him. It's a fascinating.
Nung nakilala ko siya, at least from a distance, nakikita, he's not a pie-in-the-sky idealist.
Yeah.
Hindi rin naman siya isang cynical pragmatist.
He's a pragmatic idealist.
He's a very sophisticated politician.
Right.
No? Pero at the same time, malinaw yung lalim ng kanyang prinsipyo, yung kanyang moral, ideological moorings, di ba?
Well, those
but
movies...
But Bobby's saying that will come later on even more,
I think
right?
Lumalim siya nung
nakakulong. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
I don't know kung si Sir Ronald... Nakulong ka ba, Sir Ronald?
Several times.
Yung matagal?
Hindi.
Yung ano lang, incarcerated, no?
Yeah.
But in his case kasi, and you know, I'm sure many of the people watching are younger than us, so bakit
yeah, exactly, lang. Exactly.
But in those 7 years and 7 months, nag-hunger strike siya.
Yeah.
Because he felt that...
I've seen that, yeah.
He felt that he was unjustly being... kept in jail. In fact, hindi ako nagkakamali, wala pa talagang formal charges yun for a long time, di ba?
Yeah.
Nakulong siya na wala mang formal charges.
Anong result ulit ang sinabi ng Marcos government? Bakit siya nakulong? Bakit siya
Sedition ba?
Sedition.
Hindi lang sedition kasi firing squad eh. So it had to be higher than sedition. Had to be higher than that.
Conspiracy to overthrow the government.
Anong case yun talaga. Technical case ng kinuman sa kanya.
But tinadulan siya ng death.
Kasabay niya mga komunista eh. Yeah. Nilihin niya siya. Nakita ko yung picture niya eh. Kasabay niya sila Victor Corpus. Kasabay niya sila Roger Posadas. Mm. No? Mga kwanto eh. Mga Central Committee.
Mga red tag.
Politburo yung katabi niya.
The original red tag. Diba? Yes, sure, yes. At that time, maraming red tag.
Yes.
So, and this is the yellow-red conspiracy theory na, di ba? Magkatabi yung liberal.
Wala pa yung yellow nito. Actually, I'll tell you about the yellow.
But I mean, like, in a retrospective, pinaproject ng Aquino is the embodiment of yellow.
Yeah. So, at that time, he was, of course, dinakip siya. And nasa kulungan siya for almost 8 years. Pero mahaba rin yung panahon yun. Noong time na naka-solitary confinement siya, they were torturing him mentally. They would play White Christmas 24 hours para mabaliw siya. You heard that about that? Did you know that?
Hindi.
They would play White Christmas sa PA for 24 hours, paulit-ulit, para mabaliw talaga siya. They took out his glasses, wala siya makita, and he really lost weight. And eventually, nung bumalik siya sa fort at he was under trial, dun siya nag-hunger strike. And he says it naman sa documentary, he says, you know, I wanted to die. Gusto ko na mamatay kasi nakita ko yung height of being a senator, being in power, being a presidential, and now, talagang laglag. Iniwan talaga siya ng mga tao. Iniwan siya ng mga tao. Tanong ko nga dyan sa nanay, tatay, sabi ko, kung presidential ka, tapos dinakip siya, wala mang nag-rally. Wala mang nag-rally. Wala mang... walang protesta, wala
takot sigurong ma-arresto rin.
That's what my parents said, maraming takot. But you were there. What was...
Well, nung panahon na yun, talagang first time yung martial law. Sa lahat, takot eh. No? Tapos troops in the streets, no? Talagang...
So tamay lahat?
Oo, tamay may lahat. No? At ang daming hinuli nun eh. Nung panahon na yun, yung mga first, second wave.
So you can imagine...
Yung mother ko kasi nasa Department of National Defense. Eh.
Really?
Oo. Nasakwan siya, ODA, Office for Detainees Affairs. Kaya kinikwento habang lumalaki ako, kinikwento ng mother ko yung mga nangyayari sa loob. No? Talagang lahat takot. No?
So, can imagine from the height of, you know, being a presidential, supposedly lalaban siya kay Imelda. Diba in 73, that's the story. That's the storyline na suddenly prisoner number one ka, nakakulong ka. Sabi talaga niya, I wanted to die.
Ikaros, gusto ko mamatay. Diba, sabi ko, yung parang diba? Myth of
got burned, no?
Yeah, grabe.
And during the time that he was doing his hunger strike, kinausap siya nung ni Father De La Costa, who was a very famous priest sa Ateneo, na, alam mo ba, matapang ka. Actually, being a coward by doing this. And I think
you
that
mean
was
giving up by on giving life? Up. Yeah, yes. I know what you're saying.
So I think yun yung time na medyo nag-start na rin yung
faith, yes.
Yung faith.
A new layer of him came out into full fruition. Parang ganun. Because he's a complex, multi-layered person.
He has this poem about the candle, di ba? And if you read that poem na parang make me a candle, parang ganun. Yeah. If you really try to understand it, it's just saying na lahat tayo kandila. And we try to provide light at that moment in history. Pero at any time, pwede ka rin mawala, di ba? So I think for him, maybe when he was a politician, he felt, I'm the guy. I'm the presidential. Yeah. But at some point, nakakulong siya, nakita niya na, oh, maybe I'm not the guy. Maybe I have a role to play. I'm like this candle na, maybe
serve
now mailaw ako,
yeah.
I've served my purpose, yeah, and it's done. You know, that's a famous, one of his famous poems na sinulat niya. And I guess, by the time na nakalaya na siya, that was in his head na, maybe I have a role to play to bring back my country to democracy. And marami, we all have a role to play. That's my role. Maybe it's to talk to Marcos and to come home.
Interesting.
So, that change happened. And a lot of people don't realize na malaking pagbabago yun sa buhay niya. Diba? And ako, growing up, ang nakikita ko, yung Ninoy na, ano na, nasa kulungan na at pagkatapos. Kasi most of the interviews are from that period. But if you talk to people before, who knew him before, they would say talaga he was a consummate politician, he was using all the tools.
Machiavellian even, I've
heard
all
the
that.
Tools to really like make sure na umangat siya, diba? So, that's an interesting story. Very, ano siya, totoong tao siya, three-dimensional yung kwento niya, may story arc, diba? Now, when he finally came home, if you remember, there's that shot, sasabi nga nila, diba, Tito Ninoy, yung assassination niya, is one of the assassinations caught on film. Because you actually see it happening.
Major ever,
you see it happening, di ba? Pag pick up sa kanya ng military, if you go back to the YouTube video, iba yung mukha niya. his face really changes. Do you remember that shot?
Yeah.
Diba? Mag-iba mukha kasi patawa-tawa siya. He's very entertaining, diba? Yes. Ine-entertain niya yung reporter, yung mga flight attendant.
All the fans inside the plane.
Oh, meron pag si crying lady, yung kinis pa siya, mga ganyan. Diba? It's all caught. But when the military comes in, tapos dinakip siya, kinuha yung kamay niyang ganyan.
Yeah, immediately.
Iba yung mukha niya. Bago yung mukha niya. And I always think to myself, nagsisi siya at that point ng movie siya.
Suddenly realize, oops.
I made a mistake.
Yeah, oops, I crossed the line. Parang ganun.
Diba? And yun yung lagi kong got real. Exactly.
Yeah.
And yun yung nasa isip ko. Tumatas balahibo ko ngayon.
Ganda na siya. Yeah.
Diba? Oh, shit. Diba? Parang ganyan. So, I always think to myself, at that moment, isip ba niya, kamali ba ako na umuwi ako? Kasi you can really see the seriousness of his face, kung paano nagbago yun.
Nag-dawn in sa kanya.
Kung bibilangin mo yung segundo, wala pang 1 minute.
Yeah.
He's shot in less than a minute from that time nagbago yung mukha niya. And, you know, I always think to myself, wala siyang nakitang end sa revolution. Hindi niya alam kung ano mangyayari. He went into this just thinking that this is what I have to do. And when he died, he didn't see any of the protests. He didn't see the 1 million people noong August 31 sa burol niya, sa yung papunta sa Manila Memorial. He didn't see people coming out. Wala siya nakita nun eh. Diba? Ang nakita lang niya, I decided to come home, pinikap ako ng militar, and you hear pusila-pusila, which is shoot. And of course, he passes away, diba? So, get to think, ano kaya ang nasa isip niya at that moment
na dinakip siya?
Wasn't it also, I mean, the rosary, the faith, I mean, Jesus Christ at this moment too, right? When he was, you know, asking like, you know, is the, you know, crucifixion, is this really the way? I think anyone who really is a man of faith or woman of faith at some point realizes it's about doing the right thing and then the rest is beyond me and I don't even have to think about it. So the humans, you're talking about the human side of him, but I think there was this parang spiritual side of him, like parang eto na yung faith ko, I'll just embrace it.
And I think that's the heroic part.
That's why we respect the guy. Yeah,
bakit ba hero si Ninoy Aquino? Sinasabi sa 500, may statue, airport. But sayang eh, sayang yung kwento. Sayang yung kwento niya na part ng kwento natin. Diba? Kwento ng Pilipinas. And what you mentioned na that faith, that's why he
that's went the last thing that will hold you, right? Because everything else is consequential. Anong, what will it bring for me? Will it mean great and all? But faith is what says, I don't care about it. I just have to do what I have to do.
Exactly.
Which is what every heroic figure... Mark, I want to ask you. Is this coming as... I don't know, is this... How do you find this conversation about all of these dimensions of Ninoy? Kasi, Pam, to be honest, diba, they're like very two-dimensional or binary. Either, oh, he's a perfect man, parang hero, and you know, and then the other, or santo, essentially. And the other side is, oh, he's this and this and that. But now we're showing the 360 degrees, which makes him even more heroic because he's even more relatable.
Kasi Mark, medyo iba ang mundo sa amin. Ito si Richard,
to be honest, this is how I view it. Iba yung...
And that's why I appreciate Mark's perspective.
Iba yung pre-2016, iba yung post-2016. Kasi before naging presidente si Digong, everyone knew about, parang everyone knew that Ninoy was a hero, yung ginawa niya, yung pagkakulong sa kanya, he fought for democracy, he fought against martial law. So alam nung, we saw that on TV. Tapos nung pagpasok nitong si Duterte nung 2016, siguro yun yung way nila to weaken yung nakikita nila na malakas na political forces. Kasi the only way to parang padapain yung Aquino and Yellow na political juggernaut at that time was to destroy it.
But Mark, I want to ask you, you are the expert. There was already the, I think, Monkey Cage, Yellow Monkey, on YouTube. I mean,
as early as 2009.
Yeah, exactly. So, my sense is, because my political consciousness comes in late 2000s, right? Is noon pa lang, I saw already this disinformation, counter narratives, and also skepticism, because you would, you know, listen to people and say, you know, if these people were so great, why is the Philippines so poor, so backward? You know what I'm saying? So it's not like Duterte, you know, it didn't follow
but
from the coconut tree.
Like hyper, ano eh.
But he built on something, right?
Were,
and then he brought it to the next
ano,
level.
They were already planting the seeds.
Exactly, planting the seeds.
That time. Pero nung the weaponization of Facebook in 2015, 2016, And alam natin hindi unique yan because the exact same thing happened sa Amerika eh. With Donald
and
Trump.
Sa UK, yeah. With Brexit.
Yeah. Everywhere, yeah.
And
Brazil, India, Turkey.
And it's the same people, by the way. It's the same group. It's Cambridge Analytica and all of their derivatives who did that, di ba? So, alam mo...
Cubao Analytica.
Yes, of course, merong disinformation na umiikot. But, you know, there was a study done recently. And lumalabas doon sa study na pagdating kay Tito Ninoy and Tita Cory, people, so may ano to, positive and negative to.
Yeah,
so they already look at them parang at the same level as the heroes of 100 years ago. You know?
Ilustrados.
Kumbaga parang ano na eh, they're already part of the consciousness ng mga tao. Unfortunately, in that study, it was Pinoy who was, whose reputation was really hit hard during the Duterte time. Pero Tito Ninoy and Tita Cory, parang nasa ibang level na sila. You know, they're at that level already. Like, kunyari, you talk about, oh, si Aguinaldo pinapatay si Bonifacio. Yeah. But that, their place in our history is already there.
Pantheon na sila.
Parang ganyan.
Pantheon
the
na sila.
The bad part
yeah.
about that is wala na yung personal
connection
exactly. which people of my age and Ronald's age still have to that time.
Good
like,
point.
Yung mga edad namin, alam namin yung where we were on August 21. Like, ikaw, how did you find out na pinatay si Tito Ninoy?
You remember that day?
Yeah.
Your emotions, how are you feeling? Can you tell us about that day? Kasi the outpouring of emotions. Yeah.
Well, nung balitaan namin yan, nakita namin sa news, sa television. No?
The following day. So, pinover naman siya ng news.
Oh, pinover
naman siya. Hindi naman siya binlock out.
Lahat kami gusto na lumabas eh. No? Pero,
how many hours before it happened? Before
hindi, ko sure kung, hindi ko sure kung yung oras. No? Pero alam ko, on that day, alam na.
That day, alam na.
At lahat gusto na lumabas. Dahil,
hindi ka kasama sa grupo na pumunta sa airport?
Hindi. Pero alam ko na may mga pumunta. Nasa news din yun. Nasa news, lumabas sa news na may pumunta.
What do you mean lumabas? Hindi ba censored dapat ang news? May management? What the heck
well,
was
that? Well, that was 83 eh.
Merong
partial or artificial lifting ng martial law nung 81.
Medyo hybrid na siya.
So may counting mixture na yan.
Not martial law, but dictatorship.
Yes, yes, yes. Kaya alam mo na may pumunta. Alam mo na may nangyari. Nung,
so,
nung simula nga, hindi mo sigurado eh. Totoo, brazen, araw, ginawa yan.
Harap
with
ng lahat
everybody.
Ng tao, with the reporters
so,
right there.
So, yung hindi ka makapaniwala eh. No? Kaya, nakadagdag yun sa galit. Actually, nakadagdag yun dun sa trigger. Nakadagdag yun sa pagkatalayos na.
Garapalan ito.
So, my father, my mother, my two brothers punta sa airport. Okay.
Nasaan kayo nun? Sorry.
So I was 6 years old. I was heavily obese at that time. Taba talaga ako. So sabi ng nanay ko, kung magkagulo, hindi kita mabubuhat. Diba? Kasi yun yung nanay ko pare. Na water cannon, na tear gas, na hardcore. Nanay ko pinaka-hardcore sa aming lahat. So alam niya, kung magkagulo, tatakbuhan yan. So hindi kita mabubuhat. Diyan ka lang sa bahay. So diyan ka. So naiwan ako sa bahay. I know it's funny now, di ba? But at that time, where my brothers going, yung dalawang kapatid ko, they were teenagers. Pumunta sila. And I just remember that day, yung kasambahay namin. Oh, magdasal ka. Dito kasi may malit kaming altar dun sa bahay namin. You pray may nangyari sa tito mo. And I remember so yung bahay kasi namin, yung door, para siyang sliding door. So parang ganyan. So makikita mo yung people outside. I remember my brothers and my mother there. Nag-uusap sa labas, haba ng mga mukha. And parang you just have a core memory na
right.
You know, may nangyari.
Something big, bad happened, yeah.
So my dad, he was in the jeep. I don't even think it was a van. In the jeep that brought the body of Tito Ninoy to Fort Bonifacio.
Oh.
Okay, kasama siya. And si Tito Ninoy, growing up, he's much older than my dad. Para siya yung kuya talaga eh. You know? And ano siya, maloko siya. He would play pranks on his brothers. I've heard the Butch kinakwento niya. Maloko talaga si Tito Ninoy. Funny guy, ganyan. And kinakwento ng tatay ko sa akin na kasama sila. The body was actually not even naka-elevate. Nandun lang, nasa baba. And he kept on thinking to himself, this can't be real. This must be a prank. Baka pinaprank ako ng kapatid. Like, ganun yung nasa isip niya. Pinaprank ako nito. Imposibleng namatay siya.
Sobrang surreal kasi.
Sobrang surreal. Yeah. And then at one point daw, parang may hump and then gumalaw yung kamay ni Tito Ninoy, tapos nadaplisan siya. Oh my God. And his only thought was, see, I knew it was a prank. He must be alive.
So denial talaga siya.
Denial
all out.
Siya, no? In many ways, I think that trauma is still there
for
my father.
Yeah, absolutely.
So kami naman, sumunod kami sa Times, and yung unang gabi was in the house, sa bahay sa Times. Mm-hmm. Yung bahay sa Times, hindi siya gated subdivision, ah. So wala siyang, ano siya, doon na, Quezon Avenue na yan, di ba? So nandun siya sa bahay, kasi ang expectation ng mga kapatid ni Tito Ninoy, Tita Cory was in Boston, hindi pa siya umuwi. Expectation nila, ano bang pupunta? O konti lang yung pupunta. So doon lang talaga
kasi
sa bahay.
Kasi takot lahat, I mean, this is horrible, yeah.
But that first night, nakita nila, pumipila yung mga tao. And umabot siya ng maybe, ano, dalawa, tatlong kalsada. And then the next night, lumipat na sa Santo Domingo, where it was a bigger venue. But can you imagine, ah? Kasi looking at it now, from 2024, hindsight, you'd think differently, di ba, na, heroes welcome, marami ka agad yung nag-mourn. Hindi
given ganun, yan, eh. Exactly.
Hindi,
eh. Yeah.
At that time, they thought, you know, he's a former senator, 8 years na wala, 3 years na sa, so 10 years na siya from public service.
And people are scared.
Yeah. Nakalimutan lang to. So, that's how it started, di ba? So, to get to 86 and the EDSA Revolution is really, it's really a miracle. For those who were alive at that time, hindi mo ina-expect. And kami naman, bilang family members, so nag-start na yung mga protesta. Nag-start yung mga protests. And the first one that they would look for, si Tita Cory, of course. And then my Lola, si Lola Aurora. And then yung mga kapatid, Tito Butch, and the other siblings. And Chris, of course, was already speaking in crowds at that time. And then way down the list is ako. Only because at that time, they wanted to have a family member na magsalita sa mga protesta. So at 6, I was doing my part. I had a memorized speech. My mom made my speech. Pero mabigat siya about diktaturyan ni Pangulong Marcos, ganyan. And from 6 years old to 9 years old, maybe over 200 speaking engagements, all the way till EDSA. And dumaan ka dyan sa 84 Batasang Pambansa elections, dumaan ka sa snap elections, until EDSA, until the first senatorial in 87, which was also the constitutional plebiscite, di ba? Now, ang perspective ko as a young boy, seeing that, nung nagsisimula kami, and this is late 83, so August na matay si Tito Ninoy, siguro within a month or two, nagsastart na yung mga protesta. Sobrang liit ng mga protesta. Like, 40 tao, masaya ka na. Remember that time?
Yeah.
Pag may 40 tao, feeling mo, laking bagay na eh, di ba?
Nung namatay si Ninoy, it was qualitatively different. Paano? Rally naman kami ng rally eh. Pero,
What changed after?
Well, nung nag-rally kami, kami lang. No? Nung namatay si Ninoy, pag nagmamarcha ka, malabas yung mga tao, nagbibigay ng pagkain. Nagbibigay ng
snowball
tubig.
Siya, nag-snowball siya.
Kumagawa ng mga
yeah.
homemade placards. Pamilya. Mm-hmm. Eh dati, takot ang mga tao dahil martial law eh. No? At medyo tumatama yung red tagging ng panahon na yun. Mm-hmm. Dahil, alibawa kami, social democratic underground kami noon eh. Hindi kami kasama doon sa communist underground. No? Pero, ang identification sa amin, mga komunista rin. Mm-hmm. Di ba? Dahil wala naman difference ng panahon na yun
leftist,
eh. Diba? Kahit at that time, ang kasama namin sila Raul Daza, sila Father Intengan. Ang identification sa amin kay Ninoy. Pero yung mga karaniwang tao, hindi alam yung difference nung panahon na yun. Nung namatay si Ninoy, nakita na yung mga differences, yung political spectrum. At ang pinakamahalaga, pag nagmamarcha kayo, lumalabas yung mga tao. Unlike nung bago namatay, nung buhay pa si Ninoy, nung nasa US siya, yung mga rallies ay kayo-kayo
lang.
Dito, talaga makikita mo. Labasan ng mga tao.
And ako nakita ko yun. As a child, nakita ko
yun. Deluge, no?
Hindi siya deluge, ha? Hindi siya deluge. Hindi siya instant, eh.
Trickle siya.
It built up.
Snowball.
Diba, sir, diba?
Snowball.
And I remember...
Pero yung Santo Domingo was a game changer.
Well, August 31
yeah.
was
that
a game
was deluge.
Changer.
That was deluge.
But even then, nung may mga protesta na, so ako, I'd come back from school. Mm. I'd do my homework, go to sleep. Sa gabi, lalarga na kami. And ano yan? My mother, ako... my brother, so siksika kami sa isang magsasakay kami, Telstar. I don't know if you remember. Di nyo alam yung Telstar?
Yeah, I know
okay.
That car, yeah.
And,
boxy
car.
Yeah,
oh.
I know that, yeah.
Siguro mga yun, tatlong sortie na yun on a weekday. Aabot kami ng furthest on a weekdays Batangas sa south, and maybe aabot kami ng Tarlac sa north. But sometimes it's four corners of Tondo, apat na kanto ng Tondo, and tagpi 50 people. Yung stage noon, apat na drum, plywood, tsaka megaphone. Ganun lang. And then, eventually, after a year, suddenly, naging plaza na. Oh, marami na yung mga tao, parang plaza na. And then people would start to come. And then eventually, palaki ng palaki, which led to the snap elections, di ba? But,
yung story ng Yellow, you were saying ganun.
So, Yellow is from Taya Yellow Ribbon, the right. Song, yeah. Di ba? So, Tito Ninoy's color was not yellow when he was running.
No.
What was it? White and black and white, di ba?
I'm not sure about the color.
Or wala pa tang kulay nung
hindi pa branding na nang
context. Ako kasi I was referring to the Enrile retrospective of, you know, Liberal Party or like Aquino's and then communists and all together. But you're absolutely right. I mean, that half comes after him, right?
Yeah. So, they used, because yung kata ng Taya Yellow Ribbon, tukol sa preso. Di ba? If you still want me, Taya Yellow Ribbon on the old oak tree. So, the song itself, bagay kay Tito Ninoy, na preso, nakulong, nawala, babalik, if you still want to see me, tie a yellow ribbon. Doon siya naging yellow.
Which is why South Koreans also have that, right? May yellow ribbon din yung mga ibang leaders nila, if I remember.
Because so, nakulong rin yung mga...
Yeah, yung iba sa kanila during the dictatorship.
That's of the... That's how...
It's a universal, ano...
Yeah, that's how yellow became a thing, di ba? Because of the song.
Right.
So, Tito Ninoy actually didn't see the yellow.
The color.
Hindi nakita, di ba? Na the yellow ribbon was for him, and the yellow... Wala siya nakita doon. He didn't see the people. So, hindi naman ganun karaming tao yung pumunta sa airport. But they were mostly friends and family and supporters who were there.
And they brought yellow ribbon? I mean, may
mga yellow... Alam ko nakaputi sila, pero may mga yellow ribbons, di ba? Tama ba?
Hindi ko sure.
But
hindi pa tayo conscious sa colors nun.
Okay.
Nagsisimula pa lang.
But I'm wondering about the symbolism.
It's about na preso na kung gusto mo ako makita umuwi. Yung tayo yellow
ribbon, yes. No? Pero yung kulay ng mga political groupings, no? Wala pa yun.
It became really a thing in the snap elections. Na si Marcos Sr. naka-red at si Tita Cory naka-dilaw. Yun talaga yung kulay na yun.
Tsaka lahat ng dadaanan mo, talagang may yellow, may ribbon talaga. No?
So, back to the airport. So, my lola was there. And according to my dad, kahit marami silang mga anak, Tito Ninoy was really the favorite. Like, aminado sila na siya yung paborito. And he, of course, was killed practically in front of her. Kasi she was there at the tube. Nasa tube siya. So, I mean, the plane is there, the stairs were there, nandito yung tube, hindi siya pinadaan sa tube. So, one of my, I think it was Uncle Ken, who's married to my aunt, Tita Lupita, who was with Tito Ninoy, I remember him telling us na, nung hindi siya pinadaan sa tube, he knew something wrong. He knew there was something wrong. Kasi, nandun na eh. Malapit na sa tube eh, di ba? And nandito na yung supporters, or yung ilan, pinapasok. And yet, dinivert siya pababa nung hagdan, di ba? So, my lola was right there. And she was the one who said, huwag ayusin. And,
so, the crime can be obvious for the rest of
the line that supposedly she said, and these are in the books, although I never heard her say it herself, but in the books, nakalagay na, sabi niya, let the world see what they did to my son. And, astig rin siya. Sobra siyang astig, di ba?
She realized this is now something really world historical. I mean, potential, right? This is a martyr now.
I think it was more of yung galit niya. Let the world see what they did to my son. There's a shot of her with, I think, Lorenzo Tanyada. And they're together crying. You know? There's a famous picture of them crying. And can only imagine, di ba? Kung ano yung nasa isip rin niya. So, those days, things happened very, very fast.
Of course.
And unexpected. Kasi ang expectation talaga, at least ng tatay ko, is kung swerte ka, house arrest. Ganyan. Kung hindi ka swerte, babalik ka sa fort. The idea na papatayin siya, although people had said it, so far.
Surreal,
From their realm of possibility, di ba? So, you know, this story, I think, is worthy of being told.
So shall we ask the question? I mean, who was it? I mean, it's inevitable. Like, why is it such a big debate until now? I mean, how is your family coping with the mystery around that? Or supposed mystery?
Well, I'll go with the... Remember yung
Agana? Sorry, I had to ask that. Because I would be remiss in my duty if I don't ask that part. Diba?
I also asked this question.
Speaking of anger and justice...
Yung tanong dyan is, why didn't Tita Cory have a witch hunt? yeah. during her time, di ba? And tinanong ko yan sa tatay ko rin. Marami akong tanong sa tatay ko kasi obviously I was like 9 years old during that time.
Right, right.
So yung una kong tanong, bakit walang witch hunt? Which is something everybody asks. Yung pangalawang tanong ko is, why did we allow many of these politicos na pro-Marcos to get back? To get back. Those are my two questions, okay? So, unang-una, according to my dad, and this is according to him sa pag-uusap niya kay Tita Cory, when Tita Cory was president, she didn't want it to be about her. Na nagmukhang magiging presidente
personal
ako,
vendetta
na maging vindictive
ako. I know what to say. Yeah.
You know, and that's the kind of person she is now. Tama ba yon o mali, you know, history, and we'll all have our opinion about that. But
right.
yun yung thought process niya nung panahon.
So that was her moral decision.
My role is to bring back democracy. My role is to unify the country because this is a new, bagong umaga to para sa bansa natin. Kung gagamitin ko yung kapangyarihan ko para lang ukatin to,
I'm not
baka madiskaril, yeah, yeah, yeah. baka madiskaril pa tong proseso to. That's what she thought, according to my father. People can agree or disagree kung tama
yun. Sorry, if I'm calling you, but because this is also about Cory Aquino too. She's also a world historical figure
yes.
in a sense that she stepped up to the moment in ways that it surprised many people. I know a lot of luminaries who said they were shocked by it. They thought she's just, you know, your normal, you know, just, you know, the background kind of wife, that kind of dismissiveness, that kind of match. And then suddenly she steps up to the plate. Were you also surprised by, I mean, now, I mean, retrospect and also...
No, because I know of her as president eh. Yung aking pagkakilala kay Tita Cory.
Pero she's in the family. Like, was the family, the more adult ones, surprised that how she stepped up to the plate the way she did?
I don't think they were surprised, but... kumbaga, alam nila kasi astig siya eh. Siya yung,
so astig din
yung
talaga.
Yung mga babae sa Aquino family, yung mga tigas eh. Yung mga lalaki, medyo soft-hearted eh, di ba? Yung mga babae, yung mga astig.
Kahit nung panahon ni Pinoy, debate namin yan. Sabi ko, boss, ikalawang Aquino ka na presidente. Wala pang resolution to.
Ano sabi niya?
Dun sa nasapan. Sabi ko, boss,
baka naman, oh.
Kung tatay ko yan, habang buhay ko hahuntingin siya ba yan? Sabi ko sa kanya.
What is it?
Sabi
ko, the ends of the world, yeah.
Sa inimbok niya rule of law, no, yun ang kinapanya. At hindi siya yung tipong mapagigante. Siguro, nare siya ni Tita Cory na ganun eh. No, eh.
Is it a Christian thing, I suppose? I mean, forgiveness and...
It's a lot of things.
It's a lot of things.
It's also upbringing, it's about
what
spirituality, it's about training siguro niya sa Ateneo.
Maybe it's more of ano eh, maybe it's more of a... It's not about me. Ay, Tita Cory was like that. It's not about me. And Pinoy, I would say to a fault, was like that. It's not about me.
But this is a juxtaposition, right? Because it was always about we're not like the other side. Because Marcos as well.
No.
Imelda was all about herself, the narcissism, the dictatorship. You think it's not that?
No, hindi siya about the other side. It was basically, kung mamumuno ka, diba? Kayo ang boss ko. Yung line na yun.
So it's a transcendental
real
idea.
Real yun kay Pinoy. That's really how we felt. Yung kayo ang boss ko, that's really how we felt. So, kung gagawin niya itong personal sa kanya, and again, this is probably how he felt. You can judge for your own kung tingin mo tama o hindi. Tingin niya, kung pinuno ka, hindi ka dapat, it shouldn't be about you and your own problems and your own family. So,
yeah.
Diba?
So, he didn't do any move at that time to...
Ang alam ko, hindi. Ang alam ko, hindi. Back to Tita Cory. So, at
sorry
during
for cutting
years,
you there. I, because she's an important figure we have to talk about.
The Agrava Commission came out with a decision that it was a military operation. Correct, diba? And ano pa, hinarang pa yan or whatever. But in the end, the Agrava Commission came out with that, I guess, ruling, finding, with that finding na somebody in the military or who can manipulate the military was the one who was behind it.
Rogue operation?
Hindi nila sinabi. But umabot sila sa, it's a military operation. So, ang...
And it was partial, no?
Oh, ang nagpautos nun, yung mga tao kayang utusan ang military. Now, some people will say si Marcos was not well at that time and all of that. But ako, point ko lang is, somebody there, and hindi rin naman nila hinanap kung sino yung pumatay after. They didn't also have a credible investigation after.
So logically, the buck stops with Marcos Sr. then?
Well,
unless you buy the argument that he was not really fully in charge because of his health deterioration, factional
degradation. Somebody there made that decision. Hindi naman yung gagawin decision ng mga corporal o ng mga sarhento, di ba? Somebody had to get Galman. Somebody had to open the gate. Somebody had to allow that van to come in. Somebody told those military personnel to take him out and shoot him. Somebody told them that, and it's somebody na kayang utusan yung military. Now, as soon as a few weeks after the, or maybe a month after the assassination, may lumabas na ano, documentary yung Japanese TV, NHK. And basically, inanalyze nila na the exit wound of Tito Ninoy was sa chin niya, dito sa baba niya. So, imposible talagang si Galman yun.
Sa harap. Because yung he was angle, on, yung angle niya. Oh.
Yeah, he was on ground level. So, imposible.
Na diretsyong gag.
Hindi
yung magagaling.
Oo, na magubumirang yung balik. It had to be somebody who was above. And clearly, that's somebody in the stairs because he was going down the
from
stairs.
From the back yung shot.
And when you hear the words, pusila-pusila, which is shoot, no? Wala pa siyang a few seconds from exiting the door. So, clearly, it was somebody sa hagdan. And that was just the military. Although, up to their dying day, ayaw nilang aminin kung sino nag-utos sa kanila. Up to their dying day. Wala
ko makikita. Tanong din ako, Senator Bama. Kasi syempre, ang dami ding lumalabas nga na ibang mga stories about gun. Were you able to see yung itong huli, yung movie nung si Directare Liam?
No.
Made in Marites, you mean?
No. Yung Martyr or Murderer.
Yung Martyr or Murderer. Kasi ang dami nilang mga...
Pinod mo ba?
Yes, so
pinanood namin
pareho.
Maybe you cried. But tama ba? Na yung Martyr or Murderer is not about Tito Ninoy. It's actually about her father, about Aimee's father. About
everything is about
everything
Aimee.
Everything is about Senator Aimee.
It's about, it's about I and me and myself,
but
right?
Pero they naglabas sila ng mga iba.
Totoo yung ano ha? Totoo yung nag-usap sila ni Imelda. Totoo yun. That's real. Totoo rin yung sinabi sa kanya, huwag ka na umuwi kasi may banta sa buhay mo. Sa pagkakalam ko, totoo yun.
Naglabas sila ng mga several na mga conspiracy theories, mga iba-ibang
to spice it up. But I think the movie itself, iba ata ang sinasabi.
What it was trying to show, na hindi involved si Marcos Sr. doon sa pagpatay. So yun yung pinaka...
Ikaw talaga, Mark, di nga namin nilalangaw na nga yan, binalik mo pa eh. Pinasikat mo, gagamitin nila tong footage
I'm
just being mean. Yeah.
Sorry, overtime na tayo, but just talking about conspiracy theory. Ito, yung isang kaibigan ko, so may opisina siya. Somebody who works in that office, and this is few years ago, no? Sabi niya na nahulog siya sa upuan niya when that office mate of his said, sa pagkakaalam niya, si Tita Cory ang nagpapatay kay Tito Ninoy. Mm-hmm. Kasi gusto niya maging presidente.
Mang ridiculous.
So that, but may naniniwala, pare. So this conspiracy theory, you know, we can laugh about it or say napaka-crazy naman yan. Pero may naniniwala eh.
Dun sa movie, there's even a small part there na sinasabi na si Ninoy mismo yung nag-orchestrate nung sarili niyang...
QAnon level na, medyo QAnon na yan. Medyo...
wild
yun. Makapamura ka na talaga dyan, di ba? Unfortunately, may naniniwala dyan.
Dapat pa drug test yung ano yung
gumana. Ito may next question din. Kasi ito
Pulvoronic, yun ang Pulvoronic.
Kasi I cover it from all sides nga. Siguro na immersed na din ako masyado dun sa mga kaibigan natin na Marcos vloggers and all that. Pero I feel ang criticism ko doon sa side ng Yellow is hindi masyadong ganun kalaki yung effort to defend Ninoy's legacy. Kasi nakikita ko, lalo ngayon, if you post anything about Ninoy, pag sa TikTok kunyari, hati eh, there are people na, of course, who knows the story, yung nakwento nyo here, and there are marami din na, alam mong galing yung story nila sa YouTube, galing yung, why, bakit wala masyadong,
well, that has to change, and it will change, no? But, I remember, you know, yung pinsan ko kasi, sobrang idealistic ng tao yun. I'm sure si Sec here will agree.
Away namin niya.
Pinag-usapan na namin niya.
Sabi ko, boss, ba't di tayong sumasagot, di tayong bumabana. Sabi niya, ex-president ako eh. No? Ito yung incumbent.
Yeah. Yung It's not just that. He would always tell me, and I don't agree with him. He would always say, hindi, pinsan, primo, yan tawag niya sa akin. The truth will always come out. Huwag kang mag-alala, the truth will always come out.
The arc and, of history, the arc of history will bend towards justice kind of thing.
He always believed that. Hindi, the truth is gonna come out. Again, yung leadership nila, it's not about them eh, di ba? But I think the intensity, the volume, the frequency of social media caught everybody off guard during that time. And now, at least para sa akin, klaro, wala mo paglaban yan. Di ba? So, you know, like ito, this week we've been posting about Tito Ninoy, mm-hmm. a lot of content, and we're proud of that fact na this is somebody na mahalagang malaman ng mga tao yung kwento nila. Maybe at that time, the thought was, hindi, nasa history na yan, nasa puso na yan ng mga tao, lalabas at lalabas yan. Pero on hindsight, no, looking mm-hmm. at what happened sa social media, ano siya eh, kailangan mo siya ipaglaban talaga.
Kailangan sagutin din directly yung mga kiniklaims nila or yung mga...
You mean direct rebuttal?
Oo, direct rebuttal. Kung may mga vloggers sila, dapat may mga vloggers din. Pero sa akin ah,
easier said than done yung ganyan. Ayun ba yung vloggers sila?
So Trump's farm. Go to the Trump's farm.
Easier said than done. That's always been my advocacy from the start.
I think pagdating sa traditional media or if it's a book or history, you know, sasagutin eh. Sinasagot naman ng foundation.
Pero yun nga, mahina tayo.
Ang mahirap dyan, yung mga dark corners of the internet.
Dark web. Mahirap.
Pero parang sa YouTube and sa... That's why sinasabi ko din naman kay Richard. Parang... the yellow side or the pink side needs more vloggers. Like, kasi it's ano eh. Kumbaga, there's a market for that kind of content.
And thanks to you, I'm a mainstream. I write for Philippine Daily Inquirer. I mean, we're mainstream, but we're doing
someone,
this.
Yeah, so that's someone to answer lang yun.
Ganon kalaki. Last point, I know, Bam, you need to leave. You know, the reason I look forward to this conversation is because, you know, I'm an avid follower of, you know, comparative politics. And one country I always paid attention to is India and Rahul Gandhi. Everyone made fun of the guy just a few years ago. He's a loser, you know, he's a Italiano boy, and a question even his Indianness, posh, Cambridge, and all of that. And he did fantastic in the latest elections and really stepped up to the plate.
Nashanksi Modi, right?
Nashanksi, and one of the things he did was, when he would go all across the rural areas in India, he will remind them, the sacrificed family, no assassinating lola niya, what happened to his dad. Now, hindi kami perfecto. We may have our shortcomings, but please also don't forget the sacrifices. My family, the Gandhi
family, is part of the history of the
for the democracy of this country. No, so and it kind of worked because there was a sincerity in his eyes and the kind of a listening tour and that kind of engagement. A part of me feels me. I mean, you're almost the same age. He's like early 50s, lang siya, and he's like you. He still looks young and vibrant. And he really had also the stepping up moment.
And Modi was at the height of his power.
And everyone thought he's a foregone. Na umiyak pa yung mga pollsters, di ba? Umiyak sila. You see where I'm going, right?
Yeah.
Do you think maybe that's also a way forward for you? Because you're the torchbearer. Kaya ang ganda ng tanong ni Mark eh. I think pagdating sa legit media and all, okay na yan, settled na yan. Mahirap na, no one takes seriously on this Marites. But in the new information ecosystem, in the new political environment, you have to fight the fight, yeah.
I will take your advice.
And
to
you're
heart.
The torch bearer.
I will take your advice to heart, my friend. But yeah, ako honestly, there's no getting away from this. You know, I mean, mukha ko pa lang eh, 'di ba? 'Yun yung batikos noon sa akin. Kamukha niya yung tito niya, hindi nila alam. Tuwa naman ako pag kino-compare ko sa tito kasi idol ko siya. That used to be like there were like maybe top 5 trolling. And maybe that was like the 4th. Oh, kamukha niya yung tito niya.
Thanks.
Masaya ako doon.
Thanks.
Hindi siya kasing, ito ha, hindi siya kasing galing ng tito. Hindi talaga ako kasing galing ng tito ko, bayani yan eh. Diba? So, I actually love that trolling na kumukha niya yung tito niya. You know, just last kwento.
Please.
Senate office, I think si Sec visited me a few times in my Senate office. You remember? In my desk, which was Tito Ninoy's desk by the way. Nahiram ko yung desk niya from Concepcion.
Oh, wow.
That was his desk when he was mayor of Concepcion. Nahiram ko yun. Binili ko na rin by the way. That was a desk I used. And in front of me is this big picture of Tito Ninoy. It's his picture nung inatulan siya ng death penalty. And he has his hands like this. He was in his black t-shirt. That's a pretty famous picture. And he's basically pleading for his life. Diba? And that was in front of my desk for 6 years. To remind me na, hindi yan,
that's the legacy.
This is a responsibility that you're here. Hindi ka pwedeng duwag-duwag. Yan, pakatapang ng tito mo, kailangan.
And diba? Now you have to add the other picture. Him carrying you.
I have to look for that picture.
That's, I'm telling you, man. That will be the next chapter of your life. Whatever you want to do in your life, I think that will be your next chapter. And you see, I'm emotional about this because, you know, we may have political disagreements. We may have disagreements with tactics. But I hate it when people are questioning, you know, something special done for
in our
country.
Yeah.
And the people of this is international media. I was on quarantine because I was on travel when Pinoy passed away. And I was asked about the Aquino family's legacy. And you know what got me teary-eyed? Was yung picture ng, it was like a cartoon, na parang cartoon of Corey and the dad and anak, you can now retire. Oh my God, that got me. That really got me.
We should have another episode about Pinoy's legacy. Okay,
like, ibang episode pa yan. So I hope you understand where I'm coming. I'm very emotional about it. Yeah.
So naidagdag rin siya. Yung sa akin naman, during the time na when Direk Darrell Yap nilabas itong mga Maiden Malacanang, itong mga Murder or Murder, I started with my series dun sa vlog ko. Who is Makoy? Who is Ninoy? I think sa panahon ngayon sa social media, the best way to talk to ordinary people and yung mga tao na, yung mga bata na hindi na naabutan yung time na yun is to show, like what we did here, Ninoy as a person and
with all of the flaws,
with all of the flaws,
all of the problems,
all of the problems, all of the hopes, the mistakes, the, lahat eh. And at the same time also, yun nga, tapos iko-contrast mo yun, the time he was in prison and how it changed him and how he became a freedom fighter. So I think that's the best way talaga to show people na he's a
yung arc niya eh, it's so relatable.
Honestly, thank you for this time. Alam ko, marami tayong pwedeng pagchismisan about current politics, mga libro na nilalabas.
Si Ronald,
we can do it next time. But yes, thank you for this time to talk about Tito Ninoy, yung kwento niya. At ako personally, I really believe yung kwento niya. You know, kwento yan ng Pilipinas yan eh.
Absolutely.
Diba?
Absolutely.
So kailangan makwento yan.
And thank that's you. Why I feel offended if there's an attack on truth and the truth that there, I take it personally. Even if, you know, I've criticized all of you guys. I mean, we can have a different podcast on that. And Ronald is more prolific. Thank you so much, Senator Bam Aquino. Bam, thank you so much for that. Mabuhay ka and good luck to you with
and
your...
I'll be back. Baka pang,
yes,
dito next time.
Yes, yeah.
Fight
the good fight. Fight the good fight. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
For the record, Senator, hindi ako sang ayon dyan.
Kahit first quarter store man lang, di ba? Napakalupa naman ito, di ba? But thank you guys.
Ronald, what are you doing to me? Ronald, don't do that. Thank you so much. Let's take a picture before he leaves. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Oh, that was nice.
Thank you.